Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Nations of NATO, Shaping the Alliance's Relevance and Cohesion. Edited by Thierry Tardy. Read by Paul Heitsch. Disclaimer. The views expressed in this book are the responsibility of the sole authors and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of the institutions for which they work. Introduction. Thierry Tardy. The North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, is often portrayed as both the most successful alliance in history and an institution capable of constant adaptation to the needs of its member states. Since the end of the Cold War, NATO has had to confront a constantly changing security environment. In this period, critical junctures have occurred on at least three occasions. In the early 1990s, when NATO moved away from collective defense and embraced crisis management in the Western Balkans. Following 9/11, when it engaged in counterterrorism and deployed to Afghanistan. And, of course, in the two key moments of the 2014 Ukraine crisis and then the 2022 Russian invasion of Ukraine, when NATO moved back to collective defense in response to a resurgent Russia. All of this was done alongside a major enlargement of the organization's membership from 16 allies at the end of the Cold War to 30 by 2022. Debates about the relevance and cohesion of the alliance have accompanied this evolution. NATO's performance in the Western Balkans can be positively assessed against its peace enforcement and peace-building goals, but its record of promoting stability in Libya and Afghanistan is much more contentious. NATO has demonstrated its added value as a collective defense military alliance, yet its record as a crisis management actor or in counterterrorism is more nuanced. In addition, NATO cohesion has been affected by intra-alliance politics and divergence among allies. The first months following the invasion of Ukraine by Russia on 24 February 2022 showed a strong cohesion of allies. Yet, such cohesion has not always characterized the alliance. While NATO is ostensibly about shared interests and values, the past decade has shown up gaps at both levels. This was apparent not only throughout the term of President Trump, with Turkish President Erdogan, but also when considering the level of commitment of European allies to defense or examining eastern versus southern flank priorities. Whether the alliance is threatened from the outside or is being undermined from within has become an increasingly debated issue. These debates and questions go to the heart of how NATO functions. NATO is, first and foremost, an intergovernmental organization in which states define and implement policies. Understanding how the organization operates and how it defines its mission necessarily requires examination of its constituent parts, NATO's nations, in other words. This book thus provides a critical overview of NATO's current shape and evolution by looking at the policies of the allies. It does so at the eve of Russia's invasion of Ukraine in February 2022, placing the research in the post-Cold War context up to the new critical juncture constituted by the Ukraine War. Through the presentation and analysis of the drivers, constraints, and specificities of national policies vis-à-vis the alliance, the book offers a conspectus of NATO's contemporary functions and challenges and constitutes an important source of data for future research and comparative analysis. National policies towards NATO are analyzed by reference to two variables at the heart of NATO's evolving identity and role: alliance cohesion and NATO's relevance in the face of contemporary threats. How do allies strengthen or undermine NATO's cohesion? To what extent do their threat perceptions and policies overlap or diverge? In the same vein, how relevant is NATO to its member states, and how has such relevance evolved over time? How do allies' defense policies correlate with the NATO agenda so that the alliance is, or is perceived to be, relevant to national concerns and preferences? Conceptual framework. This volume is concerned with how NATO nations perceive the North Atlantic Alliance as responding to and furthering their security needs. It is about how central NATO's role is or should be for the Allies, and how far these states hold a common view of the Alliance's purpose. Answers to these questions inform a view of NATO's relevance and cohesion. NATO's relevance. Relevance is understood as the congruence or alignment of NATO with its security environment. It draws on rationalist thinking by which international organizations are established by states to further a number of identified goals that can vary over time. Relevance results from the ability of the organization to deliver on these goals and to adapt to changing needs. Thus, just as alliances are about responding to existing threats, their relevance is also about adaptation to evolving and new threats. The expression of adaptation at the speed of relevance is largely used in NATO circles. Organizations that fail to adapt and to deliver on their member states' needs risk losing relevance. They may become obsolete or cease to exist as a consequence. Relevance is a subjective concept, constituted of material and immaterial elements, and as such, is difficult to measure. Relevance can also vary from one member state to another based on different material circumstances or perceptions. It can also be area-specific. For example, an organization that has a multifaceted mandate can display relevance in one particular domain, but be less relevant in another. Applied to NATO, relevance relates to a mix of factors. As a military alliance, NATO is relevant to its member states so long as it provides an answer to their security concerns. Such concerns are differentiated. First, variations in threat assessment and in how the alliance should respond to the identified threats shape individual states' conceptions of NATO. Countries that have a clear Russian-focused agenda see the relevance of the alliance with different eyes to those that are looking southward. The relevance of NATO is, arguably, different for France compared to Poland, and for the United Kingdom compared to Romania. The United States, meanwhile, strikes a unique position among the Allies. Second, NATO's relevance depends on the propensity of states to develop or sustain the strategic culture that allows the alliance to effectively tackle contemporary threats. NATO can only be relevant if its members provide the resources necessary to sustain its activities as a politico-military alliance. This raises the issue not only of burden-sharing and defense spending of allies, but also of their propensity to participate in NATO-led operations. Third, the evolution of NATO to embrace an ever wider spectrum of activities impacts the perception of the organization reference. Insofar as relevance is about responding to threats, the alliance's relevance may vary according to whether it does hardcore military defense, softer crisis management, cooperative security, or resilience building. NATO's cohesion. Alliance cohesion pertains to how much its members are able to hold it together. More specifically, it is about member states' shared interests and values and how these are articulated through NATO. Simply put, cohesion can be defined as the ability of member states to agree on goals, strategy, and tactics, and coordinate activity directed towards those ends. It is a function of the distance between individual member interests and the collective alliance interest. The narrower that gap, the greater the cohesion. Cohesion is essential insofar as it reflects a sense of states' convergence that the organization embodies. As such, NATO cohesion reflects how much states agree on what threatens them and how much the alliance is perceived as an appropriate response to these threats. Traditional alliance theory would suggest that the more dangerous, proximate, and immediate the external threat is, the more likely it is that alliance cohesion will follow. Conversely, where states diverge in their threat assessment and appreciation of NATO's utility, so cohesion is challenged. Whether shared values are as central to cohesion as shared interests is open to debate. In the aftermath of the Cold War, the transformation and endurance of the alliance in the absence of a major threat was, in part, explained by the existence of shared values among states grouped together in a security community. Today's alliance's narrative continues to regard shared values as a central feature of the organization's identity, and the resurgence of strategic competition has called for renewed partnership with like-minded countries, which implies a value-based approach. The reality of intra-alliance politics is, however, more complex. And as this book will show, the importance of values to the cohesion of the alliance may not be that obvious. Two dimensions are to be considered when looking at shared values in relation to cohesion. The first is the extent to which allies agree on core political principles, including a commitment to democracy, the rule of law, individual liberties, and civilian control of the military. Cohesion is correlated with the degree of convergence on these issues. A state or group of states that diverges from the rest of the alliance on these principles undermines cohesion. A second dimension relates to domestic debates and how far political leaders, parties, or public opinion adhere to what NATO is and does. Those states that have strong anti-NATO political parties or sentiments are the most likely to affect the alliance cohesion. In the immediate aftermath of Russia's invasion of Ukraine on 24 February 2022, the alliance's cohesion was clearly strengthened, in accordance with traditional alliance theory establishing a correlation between cohesion and the proximity of the threat. Yet, in the decade preceding the strategic shock constituted by Russia's invasion of Ukraine, the alliance's cohesion had been recurrently undermined. At least four sets of issues can be noted. The first is how the Trump administration positioned itself towards NATO and the transatlantic relationship. Recurrent statements by the U.S. president on NATO and related security guarantees weakened the alliance as it called into question its credibility and triggered fears of abandonment among the most NATO-dependent allies. Second, the burden-sharing debate, and with it the level of financial commitment of European states to the alliance and the related U.S. mounting impatience, also comes as an explanatory factor of an undermined cohesion. Third, alliance cohesion has been weakened by divergences among allies about threat assessment and how central NATO should be in tackling such threats. This has been reflected in the so-called East-South debate, whereby NATO priorities should be Russian-centered or more southward-looking based on the type of threats identified. In this context, Turkey's distance from NATO values and divergences between Western countries and Turkey on both interests and values, as well as statements critical of NATO by the French president, have contributed to challenging the cohesion of the organization. Finally, at the domestic level, alliance cohesion has also been affected by the rise of populist and nationalist narratives, leading to intra-NATO rivalry, foreign policy posturing, and a weakened trust. National policies. At the two levels of cohesion and relevance, national policies play an instrumental role, and this connection provides the main justification for this volume. Fundamentally, NATO being an intergovernmental organization, its development is shaped by its members. Alliance cohesion and relevance, in other words, derive from how the allies perceive the organization, commit to and act through it, and behave in accordance with its constitutive principles. The United States obviously shapes the alliance's trajectory more than any other ally. It has determined NATO's major initiatives over the past 20 years, most notably at the point of the three aforementioned critical junctures, 1990s crisis management, post-9/11 adaptation, and the post-2014 re-embrace of collective defense. Yet, the United States has also shaken the alliance by dragging it to the Afghan theater and by questioning NATO's relevance and cohesion throughout the Trump years. Allies like France or Turkey also play significant and, at times, disruptive roles within the alliance. Both countries have been key contributors to NATO operations and activities, but their foreign policy orientations and strategic cultures can also run contrary to NATO's organizational culture or agenda. The United Kingdom, meanwhile, is, with the United States, a central pillar of the alliance. Its engagement with NATO has only grown stronger in the post-Brexit context, as the organization is the main, or even exclusive, multilateral framework of the British defense policy. On the alliance's eastern flank, the Baltic states, Poland and Romania, have played an important role in the post-2014 and, since February 2022, shift back to collective defense. They have also pushed for the centrality of this core task in response to Russia, which they see as an existential threat to their own integrity. Looking south, Italy or Spain have tried to attract the alliance to their own southern periphery, with limited results so far. In between, countries like Germany or those of Northern Europe, Denmark, the Netherlands, or Norway, are largely aligned with the United States. Germany has a pivotal role. It embodies a certain European reticence on the use of force, but at the same time is one of NATO's cohesion builders through its inclusive approach and a position that tries to reconcile NATO and the European Union, EU, defense identities. It is the political cultures and actions of these states that shape NATO's relevance and cohesion in an interdependent manner. Strong cohesion within the alliance positively impacts upon its relevance, while a lack of cohesion is likely to undermine it. This was illustrated during the Trump administration, when challenges to the alliance's cohesion and the U.S. commitment to it led to debates about alternatives to NATO as a result of its hypothetical lessened relevance. Reciprocally, the perceived relevance of the alliance shapes its cohesion as much as divergences among allies about the relevance of the organization, or its level of adaptation to new threats, for example, are likely to impact negatively its cohesion. As an example, the perceived relevance of NATO to deter Russia on the eastern flank creates a degree of cohesion among allies that is more difficult to see when looking at the southern flank. To sum up, relevance and cohesion capture how adapted the instrument is, or is perceived to be, as well as how much member states agree on the utility of the instrument, how to use it, and with what underlying principles. Methodology. Given that NATO is shaped by the preferences of its members, foreign policy as an analytical construct is to be taken seriously. Academic analysis traditionally distinguishes between foreign policy drivers linked to the international system and those drivers that are internal or domestic. This ties into the well-known level of analysis question and the issue of absolute versus relative gains, as well as to the school of thought that frames the discussion. For neo-realists, foreign policy is driven by the structure of the international system and the distribution of capabilities among states. The latter are rational actors that seek to maximize relative gains through their foreign and defense policies. Institutionalists share the rationalist approach of the realists, but also see foreign policies as context-dependent. International institutions, organizations, and regimes can thus act to regulate state behaviors and facilitate cooperation. Constructivists, meanwhile, tend to consider issues such as domestic politics, culture, or public opinion as explanatory factors of international politics. Foreign policy determinants may also be associated with self-interest or with values. Foreign policies are overwhelmingly considered as interest-driven, but those interests are modified by a state's social setting, how it interacts with other states in various environments, including an international organization like NATO. Defining what the notion of interest covers can be difficult and is certainly subjective. It happens, though, that interests are shaped by value-based considerations. Interestingly, while NATO, as a military alliance, comes probably as close as possible to what can be defined as an interest-based enterprise, the aggregation of power to balance and/or defeat a common enemy, it is also often portrayed as a value-based organization. Evidence that values play a role can be found in NATO's various post-Cold War enlargements, in operations that contained a humanitarianism justification and references to the responsibility to protect norm, and more recently in the emergence of a new confrontation with peer competitors, namely Russia and China, that are characterized inter alia but not insignificantly by the fact that they do not share the values of the Atlantic Alliance. In this context, it is understood that international organizations, IO, are mainly, although not exclusively, the result of what their member states, and among those the most powerful, want them to be. States determine IO policies, and NATO is one of the best examples of this interaction. That said, we accept that this relationship can operate in reverse. That is, IOs can, to an extent, constrain activity and shape expectations and the policies of their own members. States take engagements or are socialized within IOs, which in turn influences their own interests, preferences, and actions. This relationship is much more direct when the state in question is dependent on the organization, for its own defense in NATO's case. Among the Allies, defense dependency is a matter of degree. U.S., British, French, or Turkish defense policies are arguably less permeable to NATO influence than their Latvian, Polish, or Romanian equivalents. In this volume, we take the state as our principal level of analysis, rather than the international system, but do not prejudge whether foreign policy choices are externally or internally driven, or whether they are interest-based or value-based. We believe that foreign policy choices may result from a variety of determinants, endogenous and exogenous, drawing on interests and on values that come into play in sequence or simultaneously. Any NATO member state's policy vis-à-vis the alliance may combine such a variety of determinants, although some may trump others and some may be essential for certain allies and non-essential for others. One aim of this book is to examine these determinants and to infer from them the alliance's key features. An abundant literature has been produced since the end of the Cold War on European security, transatlantic relations, and the role of NATO in security governance. Most of this literature adopts a state-centered approach, whether from an academic perspective in reference to a neo-realist state-centric approach, or more from a policy angle, U.S. leadership in the alliance, France's return to the integrated military structure, the impact of Brexit on NATO, etc. Some publications also dedicate sections or chapters to national policies, or look at a particular defense security issue from a national perspective. This volume draws on this literature in the sense that it focuses on national policies. However, it proceeds differently as it looks at the policies of the NATO nations in a sequential and systematic manner, dedicating individual chapters to either a single ally or to a small cluster of allies. This translates into a comprehensive overview of national policies and how they impact NATO, providing data for comparative analysis and future research on NATO and its members. The chapters of this book examine national policies through a broad foreign policy analysis, FPA, framework. FPA aims to understand the sources of conduct of states in international affairs, the significance of foreign policy decision-making, the role that state and non-state actors have within the overall distinctive process, as well as the influence of institutional and social factors in shaping foreign policy. It is interested in actors, processes, issues, instruments, context, and outputs that are interrelated and constitute a foreign policy system in action. This framework assumes a certain degree of state-centrism in how NATO is characterized as an intergovernmental organization, and thus the way in which its member states shape the alliance. Equally, in looking at foreign policies, we assume that the national level is of principal importance. However, we also accept that NATO and its members interact in a mutually constitutive policy milieu, where the goals of each entity are reinforcing each other. Foreign policy is multifactorial and multi-level in nature, and we appreciate the necessity to grasp the various sources of influence in foreign policymaking, as well as being comfortable with the idea that states cannot a priori be understood simply as rational unitary actors. This broad analytical framework allows us to accommodate various international relations, IR schools of thought, that the chapter's authors may represent, and to explore how NATO is shaped by a mix of foreign policy decision-making, national motivations and preferences, material as well as ideational factors. Through such a framework, the country chapters look at a series of variables that characterize national policies, while at the same time considering where NATO lies in those policies. Ultimately, we are concerned with how these variables account for NATO's cohesion and relevance. Strategic culture. What is the nation under review's conception of the virtues and limitations of the use of force in foreign policy? How does its strategic culture shape or fit NATO's agenda? And how does strategic culture reinforce or undermine NATO's cohesion and relevance? Threat perceptions and institutional preferences. What are the main security threats to the nation under review, according to national threat assessment documents and secondary sources? How does NATO help in tackling those threats? How central is NATO, as opposed to other institutions or national initiatives, in the response to these threats? And related, is the country under review looking to alternatives, such as the EU? The perceived merits of NATO. How is NATO regarded? As a means of force aggregation? A forum for political dialogue? As a military alliance or security institution? How far does NATO meet these perceptions? How does the nation under review weigh up NATO's core defense role alongside broader security activities? Cyber, terrorism, response to pandemics, etc. U.S. and NATO dependency. What is the nation under review's degree of dependence on the U.S. and alignment with U.S. policy priorities? How far does such alignment determine NATO membership? How much is defense policy related to, similar to, or shaped by NATO policy? Interests versus values. To what extent are national policies towards NATO interest-based or value-based? How important is the liberal normative dimension of NATO policy, as opposed to a more interest-based approach, for the country under review? How do these considerations shape NATO's cohesion and relevance? Domestic issues. How supportive to NATO are domestic political parties? What are the trends in public opinion vis-à-vis NATO? Is there a danger that anti-NATO sentiments might lead to an exit from the alliance? What ministry or administration is in charge of policymaking on NATO-related affairs? How much is the legislature involved in NATO policy? Level of commitment. What is the national contribution to NATO operations, missions, and activities? How is the ally in question performing in terms of defense spending in relation to NATO's defense investment pledge? And how active is the nation in NATO's policy development? Future challenges. How does the country under review see the future of NATO? What are the issues that will likely determine future national policies toward the alliance? How is NATO perceived in the context of the U.S. pivot to the Indo-Pacific and the emergence of China as a systemic challenge, and the prevalence of strategic competition as a key variable of international politics? The analysis of these variables was accomplished prior to Russia's war on Ukraine, and the extent to which the war impacts NATO's role or national policies vis-à-vis the alliance is not addressed in this volume. Yet, the research reflects on long-term strategic cultures and policies. It accounts for variations in national behavior towards NATO over time, as much as it allows for large-scale comparative exercises from one ally to the others. Equally, the combination of a wide range of country-focused analyses informs about NATO, its cohesion and relevance. For example, variations in threat assessment or on how central the use of military force is may help to explain NATO's lack of cohesion or its challenged relevance. By the same token, the alliance will display greater cohesion if the allies hold common threat perceptions or have similar approaches to the use of force, or indeed take similar positions on the importance of democracy, the rule of law, and international order. Structure of the book. The book is comprised of 12 chapters looking at 16 countries. It is preceded by a chapter presenting the main findings of the country's analysis and exploring what this says about the alliance's relevance and cohesion. The countries examined are Canada and Norway in the same chapter, authored by Stephanie Van Hlatke and Mats Berdahl, Denmark and the Netherlands in the same chapter, authored by Stein Runing and Peter van Ham, Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, in the same chapter, authored by Christy Reich and Margarita Schechelgita, France, authored by Elise Panier, Germany, authored by Sophia Besch, Italy, authored by Alessandro Maroni, Poland, authored by Justina Gotkowska, Romania, authored by Dumitru Minzerari, Spain, authored by Felix Arteaga, Turkey, authored by John Casapolu, the United Kingdom, authored by Mark Weber, and the United States, authored by Heidi Hart. Addressing multiple states in a single chapter ought not to be interpreted as underappreciating the specificities or strategic singularity of individual allies. Canada's strategic culture is different from Norway's, Denmark's is different from that of the Netherlands, as much as each Baltic state has its own peculiarities. Yet, some countries share characteristics that justify a combined treatment. Canada and Norway have in common an Atlanticist orientation as well as their high north exposure. Denmark and the Netherlands also share a long-standing Atlanticist tradition, and both harbor skepticism towards EU defense aspirations that might undermine NATO's centrality. As for the Baltic states, their security policies have been largely shaped by a shared history as former Soviet republics, as well as by the perception that being a member of the alliance helps in addressing their Russian-centric security concerns. Our approach also meant omitting some allies. The selection made took account of geography, country size, and political and military importance, as well as significance for the alliance. We believe that the number and quality of the states examined are sufficient to be able to draw conclusions valid for the alliance in general. Each country chapter is structured in the same way, looking in sequence at the variables just listed. In the first chapter of the volume, we draw on the country chapters to offer a number of reflection points on the current nature of the alliance. That chapter first builds a typology of allies based on how they see and behave within the alliance. Three categories of states are identified in this connection: the non-NATO aligned with a broad security agenda, a group made up of the United States, France, and Turkey; the NATO aligned with a Russian-centric security agenda, a group comprising the three Baltic states, Norway, Poland, and Romania; and the NATO aligned with a non-Russian-centric security agenda, which includes the United Kingdom, Germany, Italy, Canada, Denmark, the Netherlands, and Spain. Second, the chapter draws on the country analyses to identify key findings that characterize contemporary NATO. Third, it reflects on those findings to assess the level of relevance and cohesion that the alliance enjoys in an ever more uncertain world. 1. NATO's Nations, Relevance, and Cohesion. Thierry Tardy. NATO is often defined as a political military alliance and analyzed as such. It aggregates 30 nations that are keen to pull resources together so that they can better address shared threats. Over the past 30 years or so, NATO has also evolved to embrace a number of tasks that have altered its status as a military alliance. Today, it is also a security institution whose activities and concerns go beyond the remit of an alliance. The recent narratives on climate change or resilience are the latest examples of a transformative process that started with the shift to crisis management in the 1990s and continued with the counterterrorism agenda after 9/11, to then include the response to cyber or hybrid threats over the past decade. These changes have raised the questions of how relevant the alliance is as a military alliance and how relevant it is to the new tasks. If NATO has evolved to adapt to a changing security environment and to the security needs of its member states, what remains, though, a central characteristic of the alliance is its intergovernmental nature. NATO is fundamentally a state-led organization, the activities of which are determined by what the allies, and among them the most powerful, agree on doing. This observation does not mean that we approach NATO through an exclusive rationalist-realist lens. We do assume a level of state-centrism, which characterizes NATO as an intergovernmental organization. However, we also consider the multifactorial and multi-level elements of foreign policy, which are central to the foreign policy approach that guides this work. Two assumptions follow. First, at the level of the state, there is a need to grasp the various sources of influence in foreign policymaking. States cannot simply be understood as rational unitary actors. Second, as an international organization, NATO has an existence on its own that is not the sole result of state-led processes. Over time, it has acquired an identity as an international actor that makes it somehow distinct from its members, and that allows it to shape their policies. States take engagements or are socialized within NATO, which in turn influences their own interests, preferences, and actions. That said, NATO nations make NATO more than anything else, through more or less rational processes. They define its mandate, its core tasks, and provide its capabilities. By doing so, allies build, or not, NATO's relevance, as much as they foster, or not, its cohesion. This suggests that looking at NATO, understanding what it is and does, is not possible without looking at its member states and the constitutive elements of their foreign and defense policies. More specifically, the way allies combine domestic and external preferences to define their own policies vis-à-vis NATO is central to what the organization has become. This claim provides the main justification of the book. That is, as explained in the introduction of this volume, we will understand NATO better by looking at what its members are aspiring to do within and through the alliance. This chapter draws on this line of thought and on analysis in subsequent chapters to offer a number of reflection points on the nature of the alliance. It first builds a typology of allies based on the nature of their interaction with the alliance. Three categories of ally are identified: the non-NATO aligned with a broad security agenda, a group composed of the United States, France, and Turkey; the NATO aligned with a Russian-centric security agenda, a group composed of the three Baltic states, Norway, Poland, and Romania; and the NATO aligned with a non-Russian-centric security agenda, which includes the United Kingdom, Germany, Italy, Canada, Denmark, the Netherlands, and Spain. Second, the chapter draws on the analysis of 16 allies offered in the 12 subsequent chapters to identify seven key findings on contemporary NATO, which refer to NATO's persistence, the nature of the bilateral link with the United States, the perception about the collective defense mandate, the importance of values, the existence of alternatives to NATO, the debate about task expansion, and the level of strategic thinking about the alliance. Third, the chapter reflects on these findings to assess the level of relevance and cohesion that the alliance enjoys. Three categories of ally. While the alliance is intergovernmental and composed of states that are theoretically equal within the institution, it is undeniably dominated by one state, the United States, and brings together political entities that are very different in terms of their size as much as in terms of their political culture, their threat assessment, or their relation to the alliance. Against this backdrop, allies can be placed in various groupings based on a range of variables. NATO and the United States. Central. First, at the political level, states vary based on the degree of correlation between their own foreign defense policy and NATO's agenda, as well as their degree of dependency vis-à-vis the United States. The link to the United States is key to any state's presence in NATO, and it largely determines the degree of alignment with what NATO does. Yet, some allies may have a foreign policy agenda that is broader than NATO's, or at times different, as much as they may be more or less politically close to or dependent upon the United States. These variations impact the degree of alignment of national policies with the NATO agenda. While some allies' defense policies are largely a product of what is designed within the Atlantic Alliance, the policies of some others are to a great extent distinct from NATO's position. Russian-centric versus broader security agenda. Second, threat assessment across the board leads to various categories of allies. In particular, variations occur depending on how wide versus Russian-centric the security agenda of allies is. Of course, the 2022 Ukraine war has significantly increased the centrality of the Russian agenda in most NATO allies. From a longer-term perspective, though, some states' defense policies had, for some time, been largely single task, with the deterrence and defense of Russia being the exclusive mission, be it nationally or through NATO. This has shaped their conception of the alliance's role and their vision of how it should or should not evolve. And insofar as the United States shares this single-task approach in its engagement with NATO, then the link between these allies and the United States is affected accordingly. For others, threats are much wider and can emanate from other types of actors than Russia. This can be threats coming from the South and the instability that it produces. Terrorism, mass migration, weapons of mass destruction, WMD proliferation, the impact of climate change, or, when broadening the lens, the rise of China. The Ukraine war has made those threats less immediate, yet they have not disappeared and will continue to matter to quite a few NATO allies. NATO's exclusivity. Third, at the institutional level, variations among allies follow from how exclusive NATO is seen as a defense institution versus alternative options. NATO is only one among several security instruments at the disposal of allies. For some, it is the preferred channel, while for others, it is one option among others, which include the national path, recourse to ad hoc coalitions, or recourse to other international organizations, such as the European Union. These differences are evident in political postures, as well as through military operations, which, for some allies, can take place outside of NATO, or even outside of any institutional framework, or nationally, while for some others, NATO is the preferred framework of action. The extent to which the United States contributes to a given military operation matters, as U.S.-led ad hoc coalitions may stand as an alternative for states that are, in principle, reticent to act outside of NATO. The 12 chapters are understood through the prism of these variables to construct three categories of NATO nations that can be characterized as the non-NATO aligned with broad security agenda, the NATO aligned with a Russian-centric security agenda, and the NATO aligned with a non-Russian-centric security agenda. Figure 1.1. The three groups of NATO allies. Non-NATO aligned broad security agenda. United States, France, Turkey. NATO aligned Russian-centric. Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Norway, Poland, Romania. NATO aligned non-Russian-centric. United Kingdom, Germany, Italy, Netherlands, Spain, Canada, Denmark. Non-NATO aligned with a broad security agenda. In the first category are states that A, have a defense policy that is not directly correlated with the NATO position and that are not systematically aligned with U.S. policy. First variable. B, have a security agenda that goes well beyond NATO's. Second variable. C, do not necessarily see NATO as an exclusive forum for their own defense policy. Third variable. Only three of the 16 states examined fit this category: the United States, Turkey, and France. These three countries have a foreign and defense policy that is largely independent from NATO, and that is only to a small degree shaped by NATO's agenda. The defense policies of France and Turkey are also independent of the United States, although they may depend upon it for certain capabilities. Russia is an important component of the three countries' agenda shaping, yet it does not primarily determine their defense posture. These states also have security interests, and for Turkey, values, that do not per se coincide with what can be defined as the core of NATO interests or values. As a matter of fact, they are also the countries whose interests may diverge from one another, which is less the case with the other two groupings in which security interests are more homogeneous. These three countries may resort to NATO to implement a particular aspect of their defense policy, and obviously they, at least the United States, play a central role in shaping NATO's agenda. But they have other options and indeed operate militarily a lot outside the NATO framework. More specifically, they are military capable and, as such, regularly conduct national operations, which would be difficult to contemplate for the rest of the Allies. In the case of France, the European Union, EU, is seen as a serious alternative to NATO, with a level of ambition, encapsulated in the notion of European strategic autonomy, that is unmatched in other allies that are also EU member states. To summarize, these three states are security providers that are the most politically and militarily independent from NATO, and are the ones for which NATO is the most dispensable. Interestingly enough, these three states are also the ones where a debate on withdrawal from NATO is possible, and where actual withdrawal is not inconceivable, attesting to a certain political distance between them and what NATO is or brings. Arguably, these three states are also the ones, among the 16 looked at, that are potentially the most disruptive within the alliance, and that can, through their posture, statements, or distance from NATO values be the most damaging to the alliance's overall cohesion. NATO aligned with a Russia-centric security agenda. The second category of allies is composed of states whose defense policy is the most aligned with or dependent upon NATO and the United States. First variable. They share an existential threat, Russia, that, to a large degree, determines their defense agenda. Second variable. Those states have no alternative to NATO for their defense policy and military operations. Third variable. Poland, the three Baltic states, Romania, and, to an extent, Norway, belong to this category. These allies are the ones that benefit the most from their membership of NATO in the sense that the costs of being members are significantly lower than the gains. Geography and history determine these states' Russian-centric security agenda. Incidentally, in none of these states had the pre-2014 NATO policy of approaching Russia as a partner really percolated, as they never ceased to see Russia as a potential threat, with the 2014 Ukraine crisis and, of course, 2022 war only confirming that analysis. Combined with a number of vulnerabilities of these allies, the Russian-centric approach justifies both the centrality of these states' bilateral relationship with the United States and their support of and alignment with NATO's deterrence and defense posture on the eastern flank. While this makes them security consumers, these states have also played an important role in shaping NATO's evolution and in the alliance's reorientation to collective defense post-2014. Today, their defense and capability development policies are largely determined by NATO. They also, by and large, meet the 2% of defense spending against gross domestic product, GDP, defense investment pledge, which will only be confirmed in the post-February 2022, the start of the Ukraine war, environment. Their contribution to NATO operations outside the eastern flank, in Afghanistan, for example, was motivated by the need to project a security provider profile, as well as to develop and sustain the link with the United States. For these states, if an alternative to NATO were to exist, it would be the United States rather than the EU or the national framework. They fear abandonment from the United States and are concerned about the widening of the security agenda, as with China, insofar as it takes NATO away from tackling Russia. In the same vein, it is in these states that the prospects of dialogue with Russia prior to 24 February was seen with the most skepticism. In part, because they doubted that the Russians would engage in any constructive dialogue with the alliance, but also as they feared that any deal with Russia would inevitably be made at their expense. NATO aligned with a non-Russian-centric security agenda. The third category brings together allies whose defense policy is largely aligned with NATO and the United States, first variable, though to a lesser degree than the second group. While Russia features prominently in those states' threat assessments, their security agenda is broader and includes issues where NATO is not a first responder, second variable. It follows that these states can consider alternatives to NATO, depending on the issue at stake. Third variable. Countries in this category include Canada, Denmark, Germany, Italy, the Netherlands, Spain, and the United Kingdom. These allies share an Atlanticist orientation, though the relationship with the United States can be quite different from one to the other, and have security interests that largely align with NATO's agenda. Their defense policies are thus, to a large degree, shaped by the alliance, with quite a few of them being more agenda takers than agenda shapers. This grouping contains a mix of security providers and security consumers, yet quite a few of them can provide limited but high-quality military assets. The security agenda among allies in this group varies. It is either significantly larger than for countries in the second group, like for the United Kingdom and, to an extent, Italy, or relatively narrow but not necessarily Russian-centered, as for Spain or Canada. Some of these allies have security interests in areas that are less of a priority for NATO, like Italy and, to an extent, Spain with the southern flank, and actually share a frustration at a lack of priority accorded to this direction in NATO policy. Some of these allies make significant contributions to NATO operations, from the United Kingdom, Italy, and Germany's contribution to the International Security Assistance Force, ISAF, to the British, Canadian, and German participation in the Enhanced Forward Presence, EFP, on the eastern flank. Yet, with the exception of the United Kingdom, states in this group tend to sit below the 2% defense spending target, at least through the 2010s and up to February 2022, something which has created tensions within the alliance in relation to burden sharing, as has been the case with Germany. By contrast with the second group, some of these states also consider alternative options to NATO, although not necessarily for collective defense. Alternatives can be the EU, in particular for crisis management and cooperative security activities, or ad hoc coalitions. The EU's security function is particularly important for allies like Germany, Italy, or Spain, although it shall not be conceived of as a substitute to the alliance's defense prerogatives. Canada also seems to favor a non-NATO involvement in the High North, privileging instead bilateral dealings or non-security forums like the Arctic Council. Quite a few of these countries fear entrapment on the eastern flank, as they do not characterize Russia in the same terms as countries of the second grouping. The United Kingdom deserves particular treatment in this typology. It belongs to this third grouping based on the three of four identified variables, in particular when looking at the issues of alignment on the United States and the existence of alternative options, which are both discriminating variables when comparing with France and Turkey. The fact is that the United Kingdom is simultaneously one of the most militarily capable allies, and the one that, in a way, best personifies a NATO standard, which neither France nor Turkey does. A state's perspective on NATO. As explained in the introduction, the country chapters look at a series of variables: strategic culture, relations with the United States, threat perceptions, public support of NATO, participation in NATO operations and activities, defense spending, approach to NATO core tasks, and future challenges. Systematic analysis of these variables across 12 chapters allows us to identify 7 key findings relevant to the nature of the alliance. The alliance still matters. The first finding is the existence of a sense of renewed significance accorded to NATO in the face of an increasingly dangerous and complex security environment. Prior to the start of the Ukraine war, some states had issues with what the alliance was and how it evolved, and some feared what may happen in the future, notably in terms of its role vis-à-vis China or the widening security agenda. As we heard earlier, that the countries of the first group, United States, France, and Turkey, are not immune to anti-NATO sentiments, which in the long term may seriously threaten the alliance. Yet, in none of the countries analyzed have the executive or legislature taken a consistent view that the alliance lacks relevance or that their nation could do without it. In fact, all countries examined seem to accept the utility and even centrality of NATO in furthering their security interests, which was only confirmed by Russia's aggression towards Ukraine. For many governments, the resurgence of Russia as of 2014 acted as a booster to alliance relevance. Equally, allies that did not feel directly threatened by Russia still saw NATO as an essential safeguard in the face of complex security challenges. With important national variations, this view is also generally held by public opinion. The United States matters more than the alliance. Second, While the alliance matters to its members, the U.S. presence within and commitment to the alliance appears to matter even more. Most chapters suggest that support for NATO is a consequence of the fact that it is an alliance which embeds a defense relationship with the United States. Direct bilateral relations with the United States do matter, and NATO reinforces those ties. This is an important reason why East European states have joined NATO. Even established and, at times, ambivalent allies like France or Turkey see their relationship with the United States as a key dimension of how they approach the alliance. And for most allies, whatever the alliance brings in terms of solidarity among allies, a community of values, or functional interoperability is of lesser significance than access to the U.S. security guarantee. In this context, although the U.S. response to the 2022 Russian aggression of Ukraine has revealed a strong commitment towards the alliance and security on the European continent, the U.S. strategic shift towards the Indo-Pacific is still a matter of concern for the most U.S.-dependent allies, and especially those concerned with Russia, second grouping, for whom a historic fear of abandonment always looms large. More generally, all allies examined perceive a shift in U.S. priorities as potentially affecting the alliance as well as their own policy towards it. NATO, a collective defense organization, but... Third, while the chapters concur on the need for NATO to adapt to the evolution of threats, they also largely contend that the collective defense core task is what makes NATO's relevance. This is reflected in the unanimous, in the post-Trump era, attachment to the centrality of Article 5 of the North Atlantic Treaty and in the belief that NATO remains a credible defense guarantor. Such belief has been vindicated by the events of spring 2022 in Ukraine, as it explains the move by Finland and Sweden towards the alliance. The notion of NATO's collective defense centrality is especially true for the countries that fear Russia, second grouping, but it is also valid for those allies that have a broader agenda, the first and third groupings. Basically, no chapter, meaning no ally, suggests that NATO should downgrade its principal mission, whether that be in favor of crisis management or cooperative security, the two other core tasks of the 2010 strategic concept, or in new missions, such as resilience or the response to climate change. Even those which stress that crisis management or cooperative security can be useful in the South do not advocate that this should take precedence over collective defense. And the combination of the 2014 and, incidentally, also 2022 Ukraine crisis, on the one hand, and the end of 20 years of NATO's crisis management in Afghanistan, on the other hand, has only reinforced the sentiment that the alliance should concentrate on what threatens it most. This observation also attests to the prevalence of the Russian-centered threat assessment over any other narrative within the alliance. In fact, while quite a few countries do not necessarily see Russia as an existential threat, none is compellingly pushing an alternative narrative about NATO's raison d'etre. Ironically, Russia has played the role of making NATO's collective defense task largely uncontested among allies. This said, prior to February 2022, the meaning of collective defense remained unclear for those allies that do not see Russia as the main threat to their security. Outside of Russia, what collective defense implies practically, whether in Europe, at NATO's southern periphery, or in the Indo-Pacific, by reference to China, is not obvious. What Article 5 scenarios would mean in relation to below-the-threshold threats, that is, threats that are theoretically not serious enough to trigger the Article 5 of the Washington Treaty, in the cyber domain, or in relation to hybrid threats, is also unclear. In other words, the uncertainty of the environment is matched by an uncertainty of the response and of the role of collective defense in this response. No consensus on widening the security agenda, nor on China. Fourth, and related, not all allies examined are enthusiastic at the prospect of widening NATO's agenda. This is all the more interesting as such widening has characterized NATO's evolution in the past 30 years. Here, a tension exists between, on the one hand, the necessity for the alliance to adapt to its evolving environment so that it remains relevant, and, on the other, the risks that such adaptation may carry in terms of a dilution of NATO's core tasks or the abandonment of the states for which Europe-based collective defense is of utmost importance. The Baltic states, or Poland, for example, accept the widening security agenda only insofar as it allows the alliance to adapt to the new forms of threats, hybrid, emanating from Russia. NATO's potential role in building states' resilience is another example of this evolution. By contrast, allies looking south, which for most of them are also the ones less concerned with Russia, are more comfortable with the widening of the security agenda as they see the added value of task expansion in response to threats emanating from the unstable alliance's southern periphery. Equally, countries like France and Turkey, both of which have an important counter-terrorism agenda, albeit in response to very different situations, do not necessarily see NATO as the framework through which to operate in this respect. The widening of NATO's security agenda may also come from the necessity to embrace issues in the two new domains, space and cyber, which will imply a different set of responses than the traditional state-centered military approach. But interestingly, none of the chapters suggest that NATO should focus on the consequences of climate change as an essential task for the future, and none indicate that NATO should develop a first responder role to tackle pandemics. As for China, there are more chapters that express skepticism on this informing NATO agenda, whatever that means, than countries pushing for such an evolution. Some of the most U.S.-aligned allies seem to accept the need for greater attention to the security dimension of China's emergence. But whether this means a greater involvement for NATO as opposed to an increased role of allies outside the alliance framework, as in the Australia-United Kingdom-United States-AUKUS alliance, is unclear at this stage. In general terms, though, most countries seem not to have integrated the China factor into their own thinking on the future of NATO. They have simply consented to a U.S. push to have China appear in the December 2019 and June 2021 NATO declarations, NATO 2019-2021, the latter stating that China's growing influence and international policies can present challenges that we need to address together as an alliance. The EU, not yet an alternative to NATO. Fifth, so far the relevance of the alliance does not seem to be undermined by the emergence of the EU as an alternative in defense. The EU is increasingly part of the discussion, and for some allies it has become an option in the broad security domain, but maybe with the exception of France, not as an alternative to the defense guarantees that NATO and the United States provide. The initial lessons from the Ukraine war seem to confirm this, with NATO appearing as the defense guarantor, while the EU plays a role in the domain of sanctions and funding of weapons delivery. Most states that belong to both NATO and the EU support forms of complementarity between the two institutions, with the idea that EU-led efforts in the defense domain add value only if they strengthen NATO and not if they duplicate what already exists. Variations on the role that the EU can play, different between Germany and Denmark or between France and Poland, then come from how central NATO is in the first place, as well as from a broad reflection on security and threats, and on how various actors can contribute to the response. On issues such as inter-alia resilience, climate, or cooperative security in the South, there is a recognition that NATO alone will not suffice, and that the EU can add value. Similarly, in quite a few chapters, bilateral or ad hoc multilateral frameworks are presented as tools that can play a role in addition to NATO, but never to the extent that these frameworks could jeopardize the alliance itself. At these various levels, though, increased competition between alternative frameworks has to be factored in, with possible implications for the alliance's cohesion. Finally, it is worth noting, maybe with the exception of Italy and Spain, NATO's partnerships do not feature prominently in the chapters. Partnerships are addressed in quite a few of the texts, for example, in reference to the EU, the United Nations, UN, and to cooperation frameworks such as the Mediterranean Dialogue. But in line with the marginal character of cooperative security mainly pushed by South European allies, partnerships are not portrayed as essential or strategic to most national policies vis-à-vis NATO. Values not prominent. Sixth, though NATO is often portrayed as a security community carrying a number of values, the chapters in this volume do not see the value dimension as one of NATO's important characteristics. As a matter of fact, most texts overlook the issue of values either as an important driver of membership or as a driver of NATO's own policies. In some chapters, the Baltic states and Poland, membership is presented as value-related in the sense that it signifies belonging to the Western camp. In the same vein, support of Ukraine's NATO membership in these countries pertains, in part, to the notion of free choice of the political groupings to which a country decides to belong. Yet, the value-based dimension of the alliance is of far less importance than its interest-based features. Even in relation to Turkey, an ally which arguably has issues with the principles of democracy, individual liberty, and the rule of law as defined in the preamble of the North Atlantic Treaty, divergences on values are not described as problematic to alliance cohesion. Rather, it is the foreign policy choices among allies that are presented as the source of friction. Weak strategic thinking. Seventh, the common narrative of NATO being the most successful alliance in history and being capable of constant adaptation is not explicitly questioned at the national level. There is a sense that NATO can only be central to national defense policies given the uncertainty of the environment. However, notwithstanding processes such as the NATO 2030 exercise or the adoption of a new strategic concept, with a few exceptions, allies do not seem to be engaged in deep strategic thinking about the state of their respective strategic cultures, how much they converge or diverge, and how national policies impact NATO's performance and therefore congruence with existing threats. Success is approached in the chapters with a similar indifference, as illustrated by the way 20 years of NATO presence in Afghanistan are examined. Tellingly, one major lesson of the Afghan operation seems to be more that NATO should do less expeditionary operations than any kind of strategic reflection about crisis management as a core NATO task, and what it implies in terms of objectives, methods, division of labor, or capabilities. Similarly, chapters also reveal a degree of complacency of governments vis-à-vis national posture and performance. The underperformance of many allies in reference to the Defense Investment Pledge, DIP, their position as security consumers rather than security providers, as well as some intra-alliance tensions, tend to be overlooked. In many ways, what is at stake thus seems to be more a posture, that is, the commitment to the alliance or the nature of the contribution, in Afghanistan, for example, rather than the real performance of the alliance or the effect produced at the strategic level. Whether the Ukraine war will change this is not certain. Yet, the immediate response by most allies tends to attest to some sort of strategic wake-up. What NATO's relevance and cohesion? As explained in the introduction, relevance and cohesion are essential to NATO's very existence. Were NATO to become irrelevant to the security needs of its members, or were it to be deprived of its political cohesion, it would not survive for long as a meaningful organization. It was on this basis that some scholars, in the immediate post-Cold War years, felt that NATO's days are not numbered, but its years are. So, what then do the chapters of this book tell us about NATO's relevance and cohesion? How do the 16 nations we have examined build or undermine the alliance's cohesion, and how do they contribute to and perceive its relevance? NATO's relevance. Relevance was defined in the introduction of this volume as the congruence or alignment of the alliance with its security environment. Two levels of relevance can be distinguished. The first is internal in nature and concerns the ability of NATO to deliver on the security needs of its member nations. Is NATO responding to the state's own security needs? The second is external and about the general congruence of the organization with the threat environment. Is NATO responding to threats? While the two levels should logically be closely linked, in reality, there can be some disconnect. The alliance can meet the requirements of some states while not being adapted to the broader strategic needs. As alluded to earlier, the chapters that follow indicate that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.